Hello and welcome to the podcast. I am here with Hal Gorby, who I've known for several years. We even spoke once at a young preservationist meeting. Hal is a local historian, and what would you be more of a West Virginia historian?
Well, I'm a teaching assistant professor of history at WVU,
okay.
And specialization in sort of West Virginia, Appalachian history, labor and immigration history, broadly speaking, as well. So.
Yeah, I think the one time that we were at the Young Preservationist meeting, you were talking about the coal wars.
Yeah. My most recent project I was involved with was the PBS documentary Through American Experience on the West Virginia Mine Wars.
Right.
Came out early 2016. I worked on it for probably a year plus with a film company out of Boston on it. Helped with the research and the sort of what was going to be used in the script, some of the sort of materials that then would appear on camera, sort of artifacts, newspaper headlines and such. And then was asked to come back because they needed help with the script editing and
nice.
Doing sort of proper citations and sort of documenting everything effectively. For their sort of national grants and other things.
Yeah, PBS, I think I remember you saying that PBS, they're very specific about, you know, everything has to be documented very well in the sources.
Yeah.
Yeah, they don't play around.
Yeah, and if you have National Endowment for the Humanities grants, you have to have very thorough documentation. Anytime I watch a documentary now, and if it's through PBS, I tell people it has to have anything the narrator is reading has to have 2 to 3 source
really
attributions to it. Anything that, when you see a documentary and you see and when they have a talking head or somebody that's presenting, usually you just need one that can sort of stand off as saying that is that person's express opinion,
right,
historical
right.
interpretation. Whereas anything the narrator says, which is supposed to be
researched,
it's supposed to be researched very, very, very thoroughly. So that was. That was an interesting sort of in-depth process, and it kind of went full circle in the fall when I learned that the film was nominated for an Emmy in News and Documentary.
That's awesome.
And I thought the whole film was nominated. It was nominated in only one category, and it was in research.
Perfect, right?
And I didn't know really what that meant, and then all of a sudden I got contacted by the producer for the company I worked with, and she said, well, you do realize that only applies to the handful of you that were actively in this process.
Wow.
So about a week or so later in the mail, I got this from New York, and it was the formal Emmy nomination.
You got an Emmy nomination. That's incredible.
Yeah. So my colleagues joke that I ought to introduce myself as Emmy nominated from now on. I said, well, we did. It was a great honor. We didn't win. We lost to something from the Smithsonian Channel, but that was a great honor and not something that I expected to ever do.
Yeah.
With my training. So it's probably a good way to start this off. Actually.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Because when I started my training as a historian, that was not ever something you think.
Yeah, nobody
you're
goes into it for the Oscar
or right. an Emmy or whatever.
Or the Emmy, yeah, be. Yeah. What was your earliest interest in history? When do you recall like the first time that you really got excited about history?
I think that's been true ever since I was a kid. I can't remember whenever that started. Probably whenever, you know, you stopped being interested in, you know, whatever it was when I was a kid.
Yeah.
Like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles or something like that. Early on, my interests were more, as many young people and many sort of enthusiasts are, in the Civil War.
Yeah.
Probably for the longest time. Many people who knew me as a child or a teenager would have assumed that that's what I'm doing now.
Right.
I don't really do much with that at all anymore. But, you know, going to historical battlefields, going to, you know, a place like Harper's Ferry, Antietam, Gettysburg over the years, just sort of taking in that sort of level of the past was always very intriguing to me. I was always also very intrigued by the government, sort of the presidency as well. And it, you know, until I got into high school, it was sort of more of a hobby and more of something I just, you know, thought I would just like to be involved with and interested in. I pretty much, by the time I was in high school, settled on that I was going to law school like most
Yeah, yeah.
Most people assumed that that's probably what I was going to do. And that was really what I was going to do through the first 3 years and probably month and a half of undergrad at Wheeling
really?
Jesuit
oh,
University.
Okay. Yeah.
I was dead set that that's what I was going to do. I was I majored in history, you know, knowing that I could do a variety of different things to prep for law school, do something I actually wanted to do. Did all my sort of classes in pre-law and all those types of things. Interned at a law firm. Did all in the summer of before senior year, and then somehow in the fall of senior year, fall of 2006, it was one of those sort of epiphany moments. It was one of those sort of Friday night discussions when you're in the dorm and people are talking about senior year and what are they going to do? What do you really want to do?
Yeah.
What do you think you're going to get stuck doing? And I don't remember exactly who asked me, but somebody said, well, what do you really want to do?
Yeah.
Because I don't think you really want to do this. And
wow.
And they said, I want you to give me a straight answer. Don't think about it.
Yeah.
And I said, I want to get my PhD in history and be a professor. And they said, well, then why aren't you doing that?
Yeah.
I really don't know. And so very quickly, I decided the next week that I was not doing law school. I was going to go to grad school for history. Had to prep to take the GRE because I'd been spending all that time prepping for the law school admissions test, which I tell anybody, if you do the LSAT first, the GRE seems to be much easier. Everyone says the GRE is tough and it's based more on what you know than sort of the LSAT. But basically, I had a quick turnaround and was accepted into grad school several places and decided on WVU. Mainly because in-state tuition and things like that. So I had a very interesting, quick sort of turnaround at Wheeling Jesuit. Jesuit was a great place for getting you sort of tapped into a variety of different sort of new ways of thinking about things. You know, I had a variety of different classes. I always loved my history classes, the professors that I had there. And I guess I just never sort of saw myself as going into, well, why can't I do what these folks are doing.
Right, right.
Your association with history is, you know, most people get that degree, they're going to go into, you know, teaching in, you know, high school secondary education or go to law school or do something like that. But the idea of somebody going into, you know, get your PhD and sort of, you know, get real deep into this was not something I thought of until I really got to college. So
it's not the usual path for a lot of people.
No.
I think it is interesting because a lot of times we don't see ourselves as doing something or going down a certain way for whatever reason. We have that mental block. I know, you know, recently I kind of had a similar epiphany where I thought, you know, even though I've been making films for several years now, and I still enjoy doing it. But you know, when I'm at home and I'm watching YouTube, I'm watching videos on how to fix motorcycles. Very rarely do I look at anything related to making a film, which I should, because it would definitely help me. Lord knows I need to know a lot more about filmmaking. And finally, I just, you know, on a nice sunny day, I want to be on a motorcycle. And I have always said that I wanted to learn how to fix and repair and do custom motorcycles. And but I always thought, well, that's for people that are more mechanically inclined, or for whatever reason, I didn't think it was something for me. And then right before I went to Ireland, I kind of had similar epiphany. Like, you know, I mean, I'll still do other things, but I thought, no, I'm going to, this next year, try to see if I can't learn, you know, motorcycles the way I learned filmmaking enough to be able to do it. And I think it could, you know, actually maybe even be a career. Filmmaking is not a good career choice for someone living in the Ohio Valley. It's a fun hobby, but I've not seen, it's so competitive that I don't know how you can make money at it. Enough about me. that is kind of crazy that do you remember the name of the person? Do you want to give them a shout out?
I
don't even remember.
I've been trying to think about it. I can't. I mean, it's, I think it had been a conversation that had been going on for a while. Yeah. That was the fall of senior year. It was a double major, and so I was doing the thing I always advise students not to do, is to take both capstones in the same semester.
Right.
You have to do a capstone in both majors. And I was really loving the history capstone. I was loving the research part of that. My other major, I had an idea of really what I was passionate about, what I wanted to do with that, and then I was told that I couldn't do that because it didn't fit into the sort of political viewpoints, I would say, of the people guiding the project. And I just, you know, to me, that just seemed to be a type of censorship that I didn't think that was legitimate, whereas with my history capstone, it was, you know, take your, you know, go where the evidence is.
You know,
different historians interpret things differently based on the evidence, based off of if new material becomes available, based off of the time period we live in. We can never sort of totally divorce ourselves from that. And I think partly it was in that deeper research process that it really sold me finally that this is something that I've been thinking about. Why don't I just do more with this? And in hindsight, I've heard from a number of people who majored in history in undergrad or had an interest in it. Will Wallace, one of common person that we both know, you know, same thing, you know, did mining engineering, but had this sort of side love in history and wished that he had sort of done more with that. My dad was a maintenance supervisor at the used to be One Valley Bank, then bought out by BB&T. And he had several different people that interned with him. One of them was someone who whose parents were really pushing him to go to law school. He eventually went on to Duke Law School. He's a very good attorney now, but always told Dad, you know, I wish I was doing what your son was doing because I'm not that happy. I do this because, you know, this is what I was told to do, sort of encouraged to do. You know, obviously do well at it, but, you know, there's no joy necessarily in it. Whereas, you know, with what I do now, you know, there's enough, you get enough to get by what you need. But you're also doing work that's not really work. None of it's really work. It's all sort of feeding your soul to a certain extent, I guess. So.
It's interesting. I guess for you being a historian, you think, wow, I can spend my days delving into history and get paid for that. That seems too good to be true. And I think that's sometimes we don't go for those careers because we almost think that, well, this can't be. I love this too much that they're going to pay me to do this and.
Yeah, and I think part of that's a cultural issue. I mean, my role at WVU now in the history department is as director of undergraduate studies. So I deal a lot with talking about this with kids, potential students, current students, their parents. And it's the common misconception that they have from the culture, they have from, I don't know if it comes from guidance counselors or if it comes from just their friends and their parents and families being concerned about it. But they get this idea in their head that, you know, you can't really do anything career-wise with that major or with that background. If you do this, I know there are this X, Y, and Z job that you can do. Whereas we know that, you know, if there are jobs that you can do with those majors. If you don't do well at it, just because you majored in it does not mean that you're going to be guaranteed a good job. On the flip side, you can do something like history where you can sort of, you know, do what you're passionate about, do what you're interested in, get a lot of sort of other experiences, you know, internships, study abroad, other things that kind of make you a more well-rounded person. And you're preparing yourself to do not X, Y, or Z, but A through Z possibilities. Anybody that does a major in history, the studies show that over the lifetime of their career, they end up making more the people that major in like biology, where they think they're going to go off to med school, when in reality, very few of them go off to med school.
So it's
you know, I'm glad that I had parents that did not seem to be opposed to the idea of me majoring in history. I asked them years later, was it because you thought I was going to go to law school? And they both just said, you know, just do something, you know, that you want to do. You know, my dad just would tell me, just don't end up doing something like, you know, what I'm doing. Blue collar, sort of very heavy lifting work. You know, he did a lot of hard work in his life and just said, you know, you use your head. Whatever you want to do, you just go ahead and do it. So,
yeah, you definitely don't want to, sorry, I'm just making sure that we're recording. It wouldn't be the James Wodarcyk podcast if I didn't, you know, have a couple awkward moments that I created. I think that the fact that, that you go into a career that you're passionate about, that, that you really have a love for, you're going to work harder at it. And you're going to, the times when you, you know, in between jobs or you're just trying to do that search or just to be better at your job, if you really love it, you can't help but excel at it because it's something that, that you enjoy doing. Whereas you might be a really smart person and been an excellent lawyer, but if you didn't really have a love for it, maybe you wouldn't have been the best lawyer that you could be just because you it wasn't in your heart to really push hard for it.
Yeah.
So let's talk some history.
Sure.
So you mentioned the Civil War first, and I know that, like you said, a lot of people, they get into the Civil War first. So why is that? Is that because it's so American, because there was so much information, because it wasn't that long ago, or just because it was such an important, is a little bit of everything?
I think, you know, it is the most divisive period in the country's history. Yeah. I mean, literally, the country breaks into two sides. Yeah. And in a state like West Virginia in particular, they're, you know, the stuff research shows now that 50% of the people who served fought for the Union and the other 50% served for the Confederacy.
Wow.
So it is literally divided. And I think part of that, you know, gets passed down generation after generation. And it's, you know, it's sort of this older time period as well where there's a lot that's happening. For this region in particular, it's sort of a very interesting time period because Wheeling was the center of what became this new state of West Virginia. And I think people, I think just generally people like military history.
Yeah.
Most people that are history enthusiasts, and I say everybody, regardless of background, in one way or the other, is a historical hobbyist or enthusiast at some point. Most of them like the Civil War or like World War II or like both of them.
Right.
To some extent. And so I think that was sort of, you know, you get into that sort of early on, very interested in it. Over time, when I got into undergrad, I was, you know, I'd had a lot of American history background, but when I got into undergrad, I actually didn't take, it's kind of odd now to think about it, but I didn't take that much American history in college.
Really?
Most of my classwork was in Asian history and Central and Eastern European history.
Wow.
We had a couple of very good faculty members at Wheeling Jesuit, Dr. Joe Laker and Dr. John Cox, who really were very passionate about those two areas of the world, two areas that I just did not know that much about, and you know, took many, many classes from them. I like Jesuit's program. It's a history major because it lets you sort of kind of take as much in depth that you wanted to in certain areas. You had to take, you know, other things too. But I had a very deep American history background, so I wanted to broaden things out. I was also taking a lot of philosophy classes. I took a lot of you know, political science, took econ, a lot of things that made you sort of well-rounded. And somehow out of that whole experience, you know, I got back to sort of American history. My thesis was, and anybody that knows me is going to probably remember this, that it was on President Rutherford B. Hayes, one of the presidents that had as I often joke, had one of the awesome beards of the time period. And sort of was, you know, he's known pretty much for the way he got elected, you know, the closest and sort of most controversial election in American history up to, one of the most controversial elections. And I sort of wanted to get more into depth on, well, what did the guy actually do? Because nobody seems to know anything after that controversy where he gets in. And so going into depth in that, sort of doing heavy sort of, primary, secondary research, writing a capstone paper that was quite long at the time. They actually set a limit after that semester because mine was...
How many pages was it?
I think it was like 75 pages.
Wow.
It was a little too long. I've actually looked at it recently, and it holds up pretty well. I mean, it would need to be condensed a little bit, but out of that sort of interest, then when I applied to graduate school, I kind of realized that I would probably be better set for doing sort of a more American history topic. And when you apply to graduate school, we don't get trained as generalists, which, you know, we do to a certain extent. Mm-hmm. We also are asked to sort of focus very narrowly on a research area. And for me, it was always that sort of late 19th, early 20th century, the period after the Civil War, the period before sort of we get into the real meat of the 20th century. And I was sort of debating about types of topics you could do. I met with my thesis advisor, who was then my dissertation advisor, who's now one of my colleagues in the history department. And basically, you know, I was going through these various sort of national topic ideas that I could do, you know, something on the Gilded Age, something maybe I was interested in African-American history as well and possibly doing something there. And he sort of suggested to me, well, you're from the Wheeling, Ohio Valley region. Why don't you, on that time period, why don't you do something in the area?
Yeah.
And I sort of oddly for the time thought you could actually do a sort of a formal like master's thesis dissertation on something that's sort of regional or local history. And, you know, he had just finished a book on sort of glass towns in northern West Virginia, one of the chapters being about Moundsville, where I'm actually originally from. And so, you know, we talked about it, and I thought, oh, okay, well, I can do something like that.
Yeah.
And I had a reading seminar sequence the first year I was in grad school, and in the fall we sort of did deep readings in sort of Appalachian studies and Appalachian history. And in the spring we had to sort of do a research topic. Well, we've talked about me doing something on Wheeling. I'm trying to think of something that hasn't really been done. I thought there, you know, I knew a lot about local history, and I thought, well, there's been a lot that's been done on sort of the Revolutionary period, the Civil War. And he asked me, well, what's been done after the Civil War? And honestly, whenever he asked me that question, I couldn't think of an answer.
Sure, yeah.
I said, well, Joe McCarthy and John Kennedy came, but everything in between's really not been dealt with that much. And he said, well, why don't you sort of look into that? And particularly that this is the high period of immigration to the region. Particularly sort of in Wheeling. And on a whim, he suggested, why don't you, if you went to Wheeling Jesuit, why don't you look into some of these groups that were, you know, predominantly Catholic? And so he knew someone at the Catholic diocese, and actually he knew Margaret Brennan too, and Margaret Brennan sort of got me sort of in that direction through her usual sort of persuasion. And going through sort of the materials in the diocese, I latched on to sort of the Polish Catholics at St. Ladislaus in South Wheeling, to which kind of drew back to the undergrad interest in sort of Eastern European history and immigration history, and also the fact there were Polish immigrants in Wheeling.
Hey, Polish immigrants in
Wheeling. I know my audience, so I'm trying to.
But yeah, you do. I mean, people don't, you know, the part of Ohio that I'm from, St. Clairsville, Maynard, Crescent, Barton, a lot of Polish people there, but otherwise people, they don't necessarily know that.
Yeah, and I think for me it was sort of, you know, not, I guess you could call the Gorby side of the family tree, you know, very WASP.
Yeah.
They've been here since the 1700s, you know, they've been rooted in the Upper Ohio Valley since right after the Revolution.
Oh, wow.
So the idea that, you know, he's going to do a topic on Polish Catholic immigrants, he's not Polish and he's not Roman Catholic, that's going to raise some interesting issues. But it also gives you a different perspective, to where if you were somebody who was a member of that community, you could still write a good history, but at the same time you can't be outside of it and say, well, we see how we view ourselves and we see how our family viewed ourselves over time. How did sort of the outside community also view us? Because that's what immigration is. It's a story of sort of people coming to the country, coming to a place like Wheeling, but also sort of how they interact with other immigrant groups, other sort of native-born groups as well. And as that project developed over time, and partly also starting to talk to Sean Duffy, sort of another sort of local Wheeling gem as far as local history goes, sort of got interested in this idea of sort of not sort of what I initially devised for my dissertation, of trying to do kind of what Sean did in his sort of two books on the sort of immigrant communities in Wheeling. I had this idea of doing sort of a multi-ethnic history of the region, and as time went on, that got a little too messy trying to figure out how to do something like that. So what I ended up doing was settling just on the Polish, you know, and also to an extent the Ukrainian group, which early on were sort of seen as a single immigrant entity and then sort of seen as two different groups, to sort of focus on that group from the sort of peak period of when they arrive in Wheeling in the 1870s and 80s through initially the 1920s, and then later sort of fleshing it out later after that. And sort of using that as a window into Wheeling and this region during that broader time period, a period that, you know, there really hasn't been that much written on, other than a few local histories that kind of talk about the industry, talk about some of the other aspects.
So what did most of the immigrants do during that time period when they what brought them to the Ojai Valley? Was it coal or?
Well, like most immigrants, they don't initially just come directly to Wheeling. Most of them, you know, come through to Ellis Island or one of the other ports until the Ellis Island's made the main port of entry. And maybe they start out, a lot of them start out in sort of the New Jersey sort of area, sort of working in sort of the mills, textile mills, and other sort of small steel mills and other things. A lot of them end up going into the steel industry in places like Pittsburgh, and because of how densely sort of populated that area is, being encouraged either by family or friends who initially start coming to Wheeling to start filtering there. A lot of Polish immigrants came to Wheeling initially because there was such a strong German presence here. It seems kind of odd because the Germans and the Polish didn't necessarily get along in Central Europe at that time, but they also liked to sort of be in places where there were large pockets of sort of German immigration. And so they began sort of arriving in the area, initially sort of Polish immigrants who are from sort of the German partitioned part of Poland, if any listeners are sort of wondering. Poland didn't exist as a country for about 130 years or so, from the late 18th century until the end of World War I, and it was divided up between the German, Russian, and sort of Austrian empires.
See, now I'm Polish, and I didn't even know that.
Oh, okay.
So that's
well, and that's
very interesting.
So one of the things that, and when I started the project, was to sort of ask, well, where are these people coming from? Because, you know, there's no archival collections of sort of Wheeling's Polish community. There's no, other than what's in the Catholic diocese and materials like that. A lot of it is available in the newspapers. A lot of it's available in census materials and other sort of public documents. And looking at the census over every 10 years, you could very quickly see that people had to list where they were coming from. Well, they would designate them in the census, not as Polish. They would say German Polish, Russian Polish. Language spoken would always be Polish. You could imagine a Polish immigrant, a male head of household, being asked by the census taker, well, what do you identify as? Well, I'm Polish.
Yeah.
Well, the question they would also be asked, well, who is your sovereign?
Yeah.
Well, your sovereign's not the king of Poland, because there is no kingdom of Poland. So you would say the German Kaiser, or the sort of Austrian, the emperor of Austria-Hungary or whatever. And what you quickly see is initially in this first wave, a lot of them are coming from sort of the German section. Many of them had been working in coal mines in Germany, in sort of in the area between Germany and France, and then over time start coming to the United States. Many of them have, this early group tend to have a little more of a skill set, so they may work in some of the factories, particularly the steel mills, doing a variety of sort of more skilled work. The later immigrants who come from sort of the Russian partition and more so from the Austrian-Hungarian partition tend to be much more rural, the sort of traditional image that we have of immigrants from that time period. And most of them are arriving in a place like Wheeling to either work in the various steel and sort of iron industries in the region, or to work in the coal mines of the sort of Ohio County region that are starting to expand by about the 19-teens or 20s. So you have these really sort of three sort of peak periods of immigration to the region, sort of the 1870s and 80s of the German Polish group, the 1890s and turn of the 20th century, those coming from the Russian Empire, and then the sort of earlier part right before World War I, people coming more from the sort of the Austrian part. When they arrive in a place like Wheeling, though, everyone just understands them as Polish.
Yeah.
So these sort of identifications of where you're coming from within the sort of Central European political structure, most people would often identify themselves by, this is the village I come from, or this is I come from this particular neighborhood in Warsaw. Whereas when you come to a community, and this is true for many immigrants throughout American history, one of the earliest tasks for community leaders is to sort of craft this understanding that you are Polish, you are Italian, you are Chinese. You don't have that local regional identity anymore. It may still exist, but what you really are, you're a part of this larger national community in a country that is not majority Polish, or majority German, or majority Italian. So that's a process that takes time to develop. And what I found in the research, the key institution with that was the parish in South Wheeling, which, you know, served as sort of an educational center, as sort of a place to sort of bring these various different people from a very diverse region together. And then also, which didn't really develop until the dissertation stage of this, realizing that it also served as a regional center for the communities of Poles on the Ohio side, so places like, you know, Barton, some of these coal mining communities in Belmont County in particular, in Jefferson County, and up into towards Weirton, even sort of becoming sort of more of a regional sort of cultural hub to a certain extent. That really became sort of the core element of sort of what the dissertation really became, was to see this one group as very, very influential in the region's history. If in that earlier period, Wheeling was a German city and German immigrants were the dominant group, from the period after the Civil War on, the Poles were one of the more predominant cultural groups, probably right up there with the Italians, right up there with Greek immigrants and sort of Syrian immigrants as well.
we were working for a while on a documentary about Italy, and and one of the things that kind of came up in our conversations was the idea that the culture that when the mass immigration came over, the food, the music, and everything, those kind of things almost became a time capsule, because when, you know, people think about Polish music, they think of polkas, but I doubt in Warsaw right now they're listening to the Beer Barrel Polka and eating cabbage rolls, and it's interesting how the immigrants actually serve as a time capsule, because they kind of, whatever they was going on when they left, they remember, and then that becomes part of the American Polish culture, the American Italian culture, I always found that when it comes to immigration, that was always the thing that kind of fascinated me, that how the farther they get away from home, and I guess in a larger sense with history, the farther you get away from things. I really like Dan Carlin, and he was talking about, you know, Genghis Khan gets let off the hook a lot, but he was a bad guy. He killed and impregnated a lot of people, but because none of their relatives are been alive for generations, they kind of look at, they might even say that he promoted economic growth and all these other things, it's interesting how time in that passed away. Now, this was a very important city for the, as you said, the capital during the Civil War, and I didn't realize that it was also kind of a hub for slave trade, right?
Yes.
They had up at Market Square, that was part of the...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for the sort of Appalachian South, Wheeling, and sort of other major sort of port cities on the Ohio River, and also internal cities as well, it was one of those key locations. And remember, you know, Wheeling was in Virginia. It was part of a slave state. Wheeling's economy, like many of the places in northwestern Virginia at that time, was not dominated by slavery or the slave internal slave trade or by cotton or sort of tobacco plantations, but it was an element.
Yeah.
So, you know, a lot of the planters in the Wheeling area, you know, were large farmers who had large tracts of land sort of in the east of the city, and they had slaves that would work the property. But in a place like Wheeling, what develops, it becomes a much more early on, the sort of idea of the melting pot. You know, if it's Welsh, Irish, and German immigrants early on, because it is a much heavier sort of manufacturing area, slavery never really works that well in that context.
Yeah.
And those immigrant groups that come and sort of live in the area for generations before the Civil War, bring a certain different sort of mentality towards things like the issue of slavery, particularly the German immigrants. Most of the, a good number of the German immigrants arrive after these series of failed revolutions in 1848 in Europe. Well, they come over with these sort of very small R Republican sort of ideas of freedom, personal liberty, Well, slavery is the antithesis of that. And so many of them, when they arrive, become very quickly actively involved in the 1850s, this very important period before the Civil War, in denouncing slavery and sort of supporting anti-slavery sort of politicians and politics in this part of the state, which is, you know, where what this part of the state's orientation was kind of going in that direction anyway. The immigrants who come are, you know, conveniently enough, also people who tend to also support anti-slavery viewpoints. So, you know, Wheeling's heyday is really in that sort of period when I was always very interested in that period, but then also interested by the question, well, what happened after that?
Yeah.
Because there's a lot that happens after that period, too.
Right, because what year, now it was the capital?
It's the capital twice. So it's the capital when the statehood movement starts in 1861. It's the capital of the restored government of Virginia until West Virginia is created, and then it's the capital there from 1863 until 1870. In the early 1870s, it moves to Charleston when sort of politics in the state change from the sort of Unionist sort of Republican Party to the Democratic Party. Then it comes back a few years later in the mid-1870s back to Wheeling, and Wheeling's citizens to try to lure it back and to make sure it would stay permanent, instead of it being in the first state capitol building, which is we're right now in the Ohio County Public Library. It's about a block or so away from us.
Cool building.
Yeah, very cool building. The second state capitol is built where the current city county building stands today, and if you've ever seen any pictures of it, it's this very sort of ornate structure. It's kind of amazing looking at pictures of it that same size building was on where the current location is. Very Victorian style structure, very massive structure. And it's there until 1885 when the state's voters and politics in general move it once again back to Charleston where it stays.
Yeah.
1885 is sort of an interesting transition for the city. It's moving also it's losing the capital. It's also having its major switch from sort of the iron industry and the nail industry, which had made the city Nail City, what it had been sort of known as. That had started falling behind because many of the mills in the Pittsburgh Steel District, thanks to people like Andrew Carnegie, are starting to move to steel production.
Yeah.
Wheeling's falling slightly behind that to a certain extent. There's a large labor strike that happens in 1885 in all the nail industry plants in the valley. And it's also this point when you're seeing newer types of immigrants starting to arrive in the area. So to me, in my work, it's sort of a nice sort of transition from that period of Wheeling as the capital of West Virginia, the center of the Civil War, the center of all these things that over the years, and it's not a criticism of local history, for me early on, a lot of that local history was very much centered everything before that period.
Yeah.
And then once we get to that period, well, that's when
the less glamorous.
Well, yeah, it was the last less glamorous period, and I tell a lot of the sort of folks here that do local history, particularly the folks at Wheeling National Heritage area, who I've worked with a lot over the years, that I'm very intrigued by all that history that comes after that period. Those are really the ones that open a lot of very interesting questions about: is Wheeling sort of exceptional? Is it a part of the general trends that you see affecting most of America during sort of the Gilded Age, early 20th century, the 20s, the Depression. It also gets into some of the, you know, the local history that if you're from one of these sort of later immigrant groups, you know, that's the history you like because that's the history of your family. That's the history of how you grew up or how your grandparents grew up. That earlier history is important, but your family didn't live here during that period of time. So to me, that was always very interesting. Now, it also gets into some very, you know, more trickier topics as well.
But local history can be controversial, right?
Yeah, and so, you know, it gets into things like, you know, in the late 19th, early 20th century, this is the height of sort of the debates between capital and labor, the rise of the labor movement, which Wheeling has one of the earliest sort of central trade federations in the nation. It starts in the early 1880s. Has a strong labor movement thanks to that German heritage, that Irish heritage, that carries on with these these newer immigrant groups as well. In fact, the Poles, Polish immigrants to a certain extent, are even more sort of brought into that more quicker than sort of others are. It also gets into the fact that, you know, Wheeling has a reputation after that sort of 1880s period that most locals know about, and that's the sort of, you know, the vice culture.
Sure.
Most people associate, of course, with figures like Elias and sort of others, but has a much deeper and longer history as well that's rooted in this sort of interesting sort of industrialization and sort of urbanization that takes place in this area. I mean, it's hard to see now when you drive around a place like Wheeling, and I'm telling, you know, friends in other places about, if you go to Wheeling, just imagine the development of this place, that there is very little free space by, let's say, 1900. Any pictures from that time period? It's house after house after house after house, surrounded around manufacturing establishments. Now, with sort of urban development, the sort of Route 2 highway system, you don't necessarily see that as much. But if you look at any of these old photographs, the sort of urban development that takes place in Wheeling creates a lot of problems. It grows so fast and so quickly that people are living in a very close distance from a large manufacturing establishment. They're living not that far away from the river at a time when the river floods almost every year, or has a major flood every other year. So that and that sort of interest in the local history part of this, I do want to point out, because initially my research was mainly just narrowly focused on the sort of the Polish side, the Catholic side of Wheeling at that time, and it. To kind of broaden my sort of training, I was encouraged to take a summer internship. I could do any sort of internship I wanted. WVU had a program that would fund it, which was nice, of course. And I reached out to Wheeling National Heritage Area because I knew they were sort of the local history sort of hub of activity in Wheeling. And basically said, you don't have to provide anything for me. I'm being funded through this other program. But I would like to do some sort of a public history type of project. And at that time was, and that was the summer of 2012. We started talking about in the spring of 2012 with Becca Corrales and Jeremy Morris, who was the head of WNAC at the time. And that was at the time when they were trying to do a variety of different types of things to get people into the various neighborhoods of Wheeling. They had the sort of Civil War walking tour guide that had been developed. They had several others that were developed. This was the time when Center Market was kind of being redeveloped to a certain extent. There was the beginning of the efforts to sort of revitalize downtown Wheeling as well. And so one of the things that, you know, I brought up was that, you know, a lot of the things that actually are made in Wheeling that are what make Wheeling well known at that time and to the present are things that were produced in South Wheeling, where the bulk of the factory district is for the city. And that, you know, no one really does much to talk about that area. So why don't we do... Why don't I try to do sort of a walking tour of some kind or driving tour of South Wheeling? This, number one, gets people into a part of Wheeling where they don't normally, unfortunately, tend to go. They would have gone through there because before Route 2 was built, that was the only way to get from the south of Wheeling into Wheeling was to go up Jacob Street and go right through the heart of South Wheeling. Route 2, one of the negatives of it, it basically hurt that sort of small business district that goes through Jacob Street. So part of it was to sort of say, okay, well, let's get foot traffic back there. That's, you know, at least when people are here, you know, they can go to Victorian Wheeling, they can look at downtown, they can go to Center Market. They would get to Center Market and say, well, what's all this down here? What, there seems to be a lot going to the south. Well, here's a walking tour guide that you can sort of learn about some of the famous people, the different manufacturing establishments. So working with WNAC and working particularly with Becca, who's an expert in sort of local historic preservation and history in general in the region, got me more interested not just in the material that eventually was in that walking tour guide that was came out in 2013, but also rethinking the project I was working on, that I can't just do this so narrowly focused on just the immigrants themselves, that they're not in a city like a Chicago or a New York where they live in such a closed-off community where you don't ever have to interact with anybody from the native-born population or from even some of the other immigrant groups. Wheeling is so jam-packed together that you can't avoid that. So it became also to sort of have sections where you're not just focusing sort of inwardly on the community, but then chapters where you turned out and say, okay, well, how did they deal with probably my favorite chapter, how did they deal with this sort of growing urbanization and sort of the dangers of working in the factories? How'd they deal with the flooding? How'd they deal with the sort of saloon and vice culture before Prohibition? A lot of that came out of sort of those experiences and conversations doing with the local history and working with WNAC. Over time, it also involved then having a sort of later chapter on Prohibition in Wheeling, which if you're going to talk about that time period in Wheeling's history, you can't avoid it.
Right.
I joke that I often liked some of those more nefarious parts of local history, which, you know, that's what people are interested in because that was something that affected their grandparents or parents' generation growing up in a place like this. So so it was trying to sort of maybe, you know, use a particular immigrant group, but then as a window into sort of the wider history of the region, sort of up to about 1940, the start of World War II.
Well, I think what's interesting about the Prohibition is that whenever you do something that has a massive impact, it always has a massive repercussion, and so I think that's one of the things I always found interesting of all the things that were created, both from the good guys and the bad guys, because of Prohibition, that maybe never would have existed had it never happened.
Yeah, and Wheeling is one of those places where Prohibition enforcement did not work very well. For any listeners who aren't aware, you think of nationally with Prohibition starts in 1920. Well, West Virginia voted to go dry in 1914 before we even get before we even get involved in World War I, the state has this experiment of trying to go dry. And from the beginning, the state government in Charleston basically assumes that if there's going to be any violation of the Prohibition law, it's going to happen in Ohio County. So for a period of time, almost 50% of all the enforcement from the state is centered in Wheeling.
Oh, wow.
And basically just assuming, and what I found through the research process, that Prohibition is a sort of humorous period. It's sort of a period of, well, what were you thinking? Yeah. You're going to stop these people from wanting to drink when alcohol is a part of their culture.
Yeah.
But the other side of it is, it's also a darker story, too, that, you know, powers that be sort of saw that, well, if this is going to happen, it's going to be those types of people.
Yeah.
Well, when we say those types of people, you're meaning immigrants.
Immigrants, yeah.
Catholics, the non sort of dominant groups in society. So that when enforcement agents wanted to stop anybody, they would just patrol Center or South Wheeling.
Yeah.
They'd assume, well, we're going to get somebody because this has to be where it's going on. Not assuming that, you know, there was, you know, they raided the Fort Henry Club. They raided establishments in Elm Grove and Tridelphia. But that's not until many years into Prohibition. When Prohibition starts, too, it's also, you know, a very anti-German thing. It's starting up during World War One, and this sort of fear. Sean Duffy's done a lot with this, that, you know, it's one of those key elements of sort of the national sort of fear of German culture during World War One. And Wheeling is a very German place.
Yeah.
It really loses its German identity, as Sean and others have noted, because of Prohibition.
Right.
And because of the war climate as well. So
they use Prohibition as a way to persecute maybe the lesser groups of people. It kind of seems like that's kind of what we do with the lower income communities when it comes to drugs these days.
Yeah, there's actually been a lot of scholarship by historians recently making this connection, looking back. It's thinking about sort of the era we live in now of sort of mass incarceration or targeting of sort of certain minority groups. And they say, well, wait a minute, this very humorous subject that everyone kind of just wrote off about Prohibition, you see the same thing with Prohibition.
Yeah, it's still going on.
You know, back then, this sort of same sort of mentality, the same sort of structures that over time it goes from being something that's a state sort of enforcement to something that it's mainly done by the federal government, but is also kind of oddly enforced by the states as well. So, you know, people looking at sort of anti-drug sort of enforcement now, they're starting to see, yeah. Whoa, wait a minute, the legacy of this is really started yeah. back with Prohibition.
Well, and I think one of the reasons why it's hard to connect the similarities between the two is because, as you said, it's we call it the drug enforcement policy, and we don't call it Prohibition, which is what it's still Prohibition. It's just under a different name, and it's different substances, but it's still the same thing. And I probably have an ultra liberal view about it, but I just don't think that it does more to create criminals and criminal networks than it does to prohibit people from, you know. I think, and you maybe could speak to this more, Al Capone would have never been a huge successfully, you know, have this big network had alcohol not been made illegal.
And I mean, if you look at even here, our main sort of example of that, Bill Elias,
yeah.
And my research in that time period shows that most Wheelingites, sort of particularly in the immigrant groups and ethnic communities, they didn't have a problem with folks like that, because what they were doing was really responding to a law and policy making that they thought was inherently targeting them. Now, in Wheeling, there had been a sort of vice culture, and in places like Chicago, there had been sort of organized vice that went on for years. But it kind of grows and expands with this focus on there is this thing that most people at this time do,
yeah.
That's being outlawed,
yeah.
Or at least the sale or transport, sure. of it's being outlawed. It's part of religious culture. It's a part of these immigrant cultures. And now we're not able to do that because the dominant society has told us that it's wrong.
Yeah.
It's not American to do that. So the people who then become distributors of alcohol and sort of become what we now see as sort of leaders of organized crime, yeah. possibly, that at that time, you know, how are they getting this alcohol? Well, they're not producing it themselves.
Yeah.
Al Capone and even someone like a Bill Elias, how they're getting well known is in the distribution of
yeah.
it. Well, where are they getting it from? They're getting it from a lot of smaller people in places like Chicago, or Pittsburgh, or Wheeling,
yeah.
who are producing it because they produced it anyway. And can also make a little bit of extra money on the side because the economy in the region at that time wasn't. In the 20s, in a place like Wheeling, the Ohio Valley, you know, in a time when you think the economy's booming, wage rates for ordinary factory workers have kind of leveled off. Cost of living has gone up. So production of moonshine whiskey
yeah.
is a way for families to get some supplemental income during a very sort of difficult period, in a period that's very quickly going to be yeah. even worse in the following decade. So, you know, it's interesting to sort of look at Prohibition from the perspective of the people who are sort of being targeted by it,
yeah.
the people who are engaging in criminal activity, but criminal activity that the vast majority of people in a place like here
yeah.
don't see it as a problem.
Right.
Wheeling, you know, at its heyday at the turn of the 20th century in 1904, had 200 registered saloons. It's hard to imagine.
Yeah.
You know, by the time Prohibition comes around, there are no saloons anymore. Yeah. There's about 200 confectionaries and restaurants
right.
and, you know, other establishments that happen to have the same addresses as those former establishments. You know, so, you know, people at the time viewed that as something that was targeting them and them specifically. And it's a good, and historians have seen, it's also a way that sort of helped bring a lot of these different immigrant groups that, you know, didn't tend to like each other or get along always. It gave them a common thing to sort of organize around that we're all being basically targeted and treated in the same sort of fashion. What we do share is we're all Roman Catholic, or we're all sort of immigrants or the children of immigrants. So when they get into sort of the 1930s and 40s, it's no surprise that politically most of these immigrant or ethnic communities support Franklin Roosevelt, support the New Deal, support the labor movement, and most of them got their sort of early sort of organizing together in response to Prohibition. In a place like Wheeling, Prohibition, they even had a longer period to think about this.
It extended past the national prohibition?
Because
it started earlier.
It started 6 years earlier, then in the state got rid of it. But if anybody that grew up in Wheeling in the mid-20th century, I mean, technically it was illegal to sell alcohol by the drink. until like the early 1970s.
Was it really?
But nobody really
yeah.
did anything. And there were all these sort of, you know, Sunday closing laws and all these other sort of elements of yeah. that era that, you know, we don't want to totally just have everything be wide open and just, yeah. you know, everything, you can basically do whatever you want. Yeah. But it was sort of realizing, you know, this hard sort of coercive form of prohibition is not productive. It's wasting a lot of money to enforce it, to pay people to sort of, they were called in the local press in Wheeling, people who didn't support prohibition, would refer to them as fizz ferrets, people that are sort of, you know, sneaking around neighborhoods in center South Wheeling, East Wheeling, trying to get the smell of sort of a still in operation in somebody's basement, and trying to sort of, you know, arrest somebody who, you know, maybe is doing this to just add some extra money. So it you know, it has an interesting sort of heritage for that period of time locally in the region's history.
The the thing I guess because of where I grew up that I find very interesting is that in the little town that I live in Barton, there was a high school and a middle school and four or five churches. And when I thought that when you mentioned how many saloons there were, because I think probably at one time in Barton had to be 5-6 of them, mm-hmm. maybe more. A grocery store with an elevator, and a post office, and a doctor, and mm-hmm. and I remember even you know, my grandparents and my parents talking about how a trip to Wheeling was maybe the way we look at going to Pittsburgh.
Yeah,
it's a trip to the big city.
Uh-huh.
And now I work in Wheeling, and I sometimes come back and forth between there and here several times a day for different things. I'll go to work, I'll come home, I'll come back for something in the evening. And it's nothing to come to Wheeling three or four times in one day. Whereas for most of those people, they would maybe once a year they would make it to Wheeling. And mm-hmm. And you know, the even just to get to another small town to go to a dance or something like that was a big deal, because the roads weren't good and not everybody had a car. And it's I remember my one uncle lost a leg jumping a train, mm-hmm. probably to get from Blaine to Barton or Maynard or something like that, you know, one small town to another. I don't know how that really relates to Wheeling, but it's just
it's actually an interesting point, and something that in doing a lot of the local history that over the years I started to become a little more aware of it. And taking this project from a dissertation to now it's sort of in the book preparation phase, was realizing that Wheeling was this sort of central cultural, business, labor hub for this wider Ohio Valley region. I had a colleague, a friend of mine, who did a book on Weirton and Hancock County sort of economic development, which is totally different than Wheeling. He initially had this idea of doing something that would look at the whole area. And then eventually, he's from Hancock County, he just said, those two areas have two completely different orientations. Weirton was created out of really nothing.
Yeah.
Hancock County was one of the most rural places in the Upper Ohio Valley as late as 1900.
Oh, wow.
Whereas Wheeling, you know, has been a cultural location since Native American times, since the sort of Revolutionary War. It's much more urban, and particularly the orientation of people that you're drawn towards Wheeling. Wheeling is a commercial hub for a lot of these smaller communities on both sides of the river, you know, because the company has its headquarters in Wheeling. One of the interesting things that came out of sort of working with WNAC was also thinking about, well, the companies that sort of become centered here in sort of central entities, such as the Wheeling Steel Corporation, it's an odd sort of business structure, because you have all of these different establishments and mills and sort of other types of plants that are on both sides of the river in every one of these little communities. It's not like Pittsburgh, where you have maybe one entity that's in Homestead and one that's the only thing that's in Braddock. Whereas when you say Wheeling Steel, you're talking about all these little communities that are now sort of, because you have this central entity, it's actually bringing them all closer together. They're also brought closer together thanks to sort of this intricate streetcar system that Wheeling was the hub of, that went out on both sides of the river connected these communities, even before they even had, you know, paved roads or bridges necessarily. So that was sort of something that it took me a while to actually think about that. And then over time, you know, growing up in the region, you start thinking, well, that's pretty obvious. I mean, people say they're from Wheeling, but then in reality, well, you know, you're from Barton.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
You know, or someone says they're from Wheeling, well, I'm from Warwood, right. Which until 1919, 1920 was not part of Wheeling. It was incorporated in later. Or someone's from Beach Bottom, but they say I'm from Wheeling.
Yeah.
So it brings people together and sort of to come either to shop here commercially or because you work for a company that is centered in headquarters in Wheeling or just culturally for, you know, the various immigrant groups, they may have a presence in a place like in Barton in particular. Yeah. In, I'm trying to think of one of those other where CrossFit is.
Lansing.
Blaine, yeah, Lansing-Blaine area. I mean, that was actually one of the bigger sort of Polish communities in the Upper Ohio Valley.
That's, well, my family, yeah.
But culturally, when you even talk to those folks, where do they go for sort of larger cultural function other than what maybe they could get at the Catholic parish that was there?
Yeah.
They went to South Wheeling and went to St. Ladislaus.
Yes.
Or they went to – they used to have sort of Polish heritage days at Ogilby Park in the 20s and 30s.
Yeah.
Which was largely out of the orbit of St. Lads and South Wheeling. So that these communities, even though they have these smaller, you know, maybe they're in a small mining town in Belmont County, but they still are drawn to Wheeling because that is the cultural hub of their immigrant group. Italians as well. If they live anywhere in the valley, they're still drawn into the Italian orbit that is here in Wheeling. So it's actually something that is very unique about the sort of historical development of this place, that, you know, you have this sort of central hub that really brings in this larger area that in some respects is, you know, in all three states, Ohio, West Virginia, and into Pennsylvania.
Yeah, I always look at where I live as being, I describe it a lot of times when I'm out of town, as being a suburb of Wheeling. It just happens to be in Ohio, but in many ways it's a distant suburb. So when it comes to when you take on a new project, where do you get most of your research from? Is it lots of hours looking at microfilm? Is it it just seems like because when it comes to history, you kind of have to be a detective, right? You have to go out and find that stuff. There's very few things that are readily available.
Yeah, I asked myself whenever I started this project, well, why hasn't anybody done anything on this time? Well, I quickly learned why.
It's not easy, right?
It's fragments. Yeah. A lot of it, and some of the detective work I love the most in the project is every chapter in what's going to become very soon this book through WVU Press. It was starting every chapter off with sort of focusing on a particular individual or family. Sort of to have some sort of a narrative component to tie everything together. So maybe if the chapter's about World War I, somebody that really speaks to that sort of World War I experience. Doing that detective work, even though it may be a page or two of text, I mean, it could take months to figure that out. In some cases, you have all this material maybe through looking at newspapers on microfilm. Or maybe some of the material that you got out of the Catholic diocese, or some of the material that we have at WVU has a lot of good material. You have to tie all these things together. Yeah. You see this person mentioned here. You see them mentioned again here. And you quickly start putting it together and realizing, wow, I have this person showing up in 10 or 12 sources over this long period of time. I can actually speak and write almost what's more of like writing fiction, sort of a strict narrative where you're talking about this person's life and you're drawing it actually out of the source material. But somebody reading that just thinks, oh, okay, well, that doesn't seem to be that hard.
Right.
Then you realize, oh, wait a minute. Found this in 2011. Found that example in 2014.
Right.
Found that example 2 weeks ago.
That piece of the puzzle.
Yeah, and and that's why no project ever ends. At some point, you have to just tell yourself, I've done as best as I can.
Yeah.
I've done justice to the subject. I have not left anything out that would egregiously misinterpret the sort of lived experience of the people. And at that point, then it's time to to call it a wraps. But a lot of the research came out of the sort of the Catholic Diocese archives, which over the years and ever since John Eric Gillot's been there, just been a wealth of information. Anybody that wants to do sort of immigration history for the state of West Virginia, that's really the place to start. Because those are sometimes the best centralized records you can get. Upstairs here in the High County Public Library in the Wheeling Room, a lot of great material there, particularly about sort of local manufacturing, the sort of local urban development. West Virginia's sort of library at WVU was very helpful. Particularly, they have the records of the Ohio Valley Trade and Labor Assembly, sort of main labor federation in the region. And also, strangely enough, sort of online databases that have become available over time. One of the things that I really mind a lot that you don't really see in a lot of this other sort of immigration history is ancestry.com. We had a free access through WVU, which is a gold mine as far as I'm concerned, that you can actually search for people to check them through all these census records, directories. It was one of the things my colleagues immediately, sort of when they were reading the manuscript, were just like, I would never have thought you could have mined genealogical sources to actually tell a much more complex narrative like this. The best source, the most fruitful source, is our newspapers. The problem is they can be the most frustrating, too.
Sure. You've got to go back and read the daily paper from...
People have joked with me, well, now it's easier because the Library of Congress digitized the Wheeling papers. Yeah. And I said, well, yeah, but those stopped in 1901. They said, well, what did you do with the rest of it? Well, upstairs or down at WVU, just looking at reel after reel of microfilm. One day you may find one article, and that's it. Then the next day you go in and you find 100. That are really, really useful. And then you have to sort of do the detective work. If you see something that you weren't looking for, and it's referencing something that happened a month ago.
Then you go back to the
papers. You can go back a month ago. Then you do that, and you start hearing them referencing something that happened a week ago. Okay. And then you find exactly what you were wanting to find. So whenever I'm teaching my students to do research and they want to use the newspapers, I tell them it's the best type of source and gold mine to find good material, but you really should do that after you've started sort of laying some of the groundwork where you have some clearer dates or some general dates in mind so that you're just not shooting blindly trying to find something. Wheeling's newspapers at that time, the Intelligencer, the News Register, you know, daily newspapers that are about 20 plus pages each day. And so to try to navigate through those, I mean, it's taken 10 years.
Yeah.
I mean, it takes a lot of time to do that. I think it's partly why when historians do a first project like that, they try to make their second or third project something where they can, you know, at least have a wider and maybe, let's say, a little bit easier accessible source base to deal with. I think because that first experience was great, it's very rewarding, but then it's also taxing as well. So
you know better than to go down that rabbit hole again. Maybe
if you know how long it took, then you realize if you do this again, it can take. And what you do is you're going along, and this is like anything, you become sort of a pack rat too. You're like, oh, wait a minute, that's very interesting. You get all these tangential things along the way where you develop sort of side projects that come out of it. For me, one of them was a few years back. Becca asked me, she was doing a series on crime in Wheeling. She said, well, do you have anything on that? Because you're one of the people I would think of that would. And I did have this side project that got included in the manuscript I was working on, but it really didn't deal with Polish immigrants. It dealt with the Italian Black Hand, the sort of early mafia in the region. And it was just more of, as a colleague told me, it's just a nice, interesting story.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, I did the research and found it and thought I had to include it. So it gets put to a side, but that was something you found as you're looking for one thing in the newspapers. You keep seeing, well, there's these trials going on at the city county building about this mafia group that operated out of East Wheeling and Center Wheeling.
It's too good to just ignore, right?
Yeah. And I said, at some point in the future, that's going to come back. And Becca was asking me about something about crime. And I said, well, I have this side piece on the Black Hand in Wheeling. And I'm describing it to her. And she's just, oh, yes, yes. Because no one knows anything about that. And I mean, it's very interesting. I mean, it was right at the time period of Prohibition starting in the state, World War I starting. And there was this Italian mafia assassination school that was running out of Wheeling.
Wow.
I mean, it was some of the most, for that time period, one of the more dramatic trials in Wheeling's history was sort of, it was on the news every day. It would be like the equivalent being on WTRF every night. Just the deep stories and sort of the sort of development, learning about all of this that was going on within largely the Italian immigrant community of Wheeling. Yeah. But also how it was affecting everyone else, and also feeding into a period of time when there's a fear of immigrants, a fear of Germans, but now also, well, maybe we ought to be fearful of this group as well. You know, and so it was one of those things that when you're doing the research, you're like, I can't really, it doesn't really fit with what I'm working on, but there's so much here that's like, oh, I have to do that. That's one story of something like that. Another story of something that was sort of a side thing that you find just doing, you know, looking at microfilm, and then actually eventually got put in, was knowing that one of the things people in this region know and have a lot of love and affection for is the culture of high school sports.
Yeah.
And that one of the things that people don't realize that also brought different immigrant communities and ethnic groups together was the integration of high school sports.
Right. Yeah.
So, you know, everyone knows the integration of sports around sort of the integration of sort of African American and white in after the Brown decision in 1954. But in the teens, 20s, and 30s, there was also this sort of cultural assimilation that takes place in the high schools in the Valley. And this is something that happens nationally, too, that prior to this, if you look at rosters of teams, and they would always reprint the teams in the newspaper, yeah, they all sound either Irish, maybe German. But they all sound very anglicized last names. Well, very quickly, the programs that start becoming very dominant in the state, Benwood Union, which people may be surprised that Benwood Union had a prolific football team. in the mid to late 20s to early 1930s, they were one of the predominant football programs in the state.
Really?
Won a number of state championships, 1928, 1931, I believe. Their coach, Everett Brinkman from South Wheeling, was sort of a famous local coach. Eventually got hired by Wheeling High and did the same thing then at Wheeling High. But what I discovered in looking at the – you'd be looking at anything in the fall in the newspapers. So let's say maybe with 1 year you're looking at the fall section. You're always having these stories about, you know, sports teams and other things. And I never really paid much attention to it because I'm dealing with these very deep, historical subjects. Well, over time, you start actually looking at the rosters of the sports teams, and you start noticing, wait a minute, there's Polish-sounding last names here. Wait a minute, that's so-and-so's son. They're at Wheeling High. They're at Wheeling Central. Wait a minute, this is interesting. So it became something that over time actually was a side story that it actually is in one of the main chapters of my manuscript is the role of high school football primarily. I could have done basketball too, but what you see is these teams start integrating these second generation, usually the children of immigrants, into their football programs. Well, what happens? Well, they're much more athletically inclined. I don't like to be stereotypical, but let's be honest. For many of the Slavic American groups, they tend to be a little more muscularly defined as well. Yeah. Most of your offensive linemen tend to have sort of Slavic-sounding last names. Yeah. And you start hearing very quickly in the descriptions in the newspaper articles, very stereotypical, but describing sort of the bruising nature of the offensive linemen for Wheeling Central, for Benwood Union, led by usually some Polish-American or Slovak-American or Croatian-American. But you start realizing, well, how did these people come together in the 1930s and 40s and things like the labor movement? Well, this is the generation when they were in high school. They played high school sports.
And they remained friends afterwards.
So if they went to Wheeling High or they went to Tridelphia, the Tridelphia high school team was largely the sons of the coal mining communities out there. But likewise, Italians, Poles, and others brought together. And while they may have rivalries with, you know, Warwood and Tridelphia had a strong rivalry at that time, Central and Wheeling High did as well. That brings these people closer together, that if you can go to school together, if you can play football together, if you then later, you know, at this time, most of these people aren't going to college. They're going straight to work for Wheeling Steel or work for the coal company or work for someone else. Then it's very easy to get along with them there and to then, you know, when something like the CIO and the labor movement comes around in the 1930s, to be very active working together in that capacity as well.
And you, when you're young like that, you bond with your peers, and especially when you get to the high school age, you kind of rebel against the family. So
that's where your main attachments are.
Yeah,
you have the family unit still, and for immigrant families, that's very important. Yeah. But after the eighth grade, you don't stop going to parochial school.
Yeah.
If you want to continue, you can go to Wheeling Central, or you can go to one of the public high schools, where that creates a different type of peer group to a certain extent.
Yeah, I don't care about what happened in the homeland. I care about what's happening on Friday night with friends.
Are we gonna beat up on Belair this week or beat up on Tiltonsville this week?
I'm less concerned that this guy's family comes from a different part of the world than I, as much as I.
He's a great right tackle, a right guard.
The people I'm against are the other team.
Yeah.
And so this is my common friend, and they're the common enemy. And it's funny how those things play out on the small scale when it comes to sports, but then it's also where wars come from, and that bonding to a group. The thing about history that I think is really cool is that it is facts, and you can't ignore the facts. But then there's also that interpretation and how much weight to give the facts. And you were saying the correlation between the different pieces of facts and trying to see how it all fits together to get an overall picture. A lot of it's using your imagination and your experience to kind of see how all the pieces fit together. And I think for to me, that's what makes historians great is that they're able to interpret the facts. Whereas if I read an old newspaper, and I could sit there and read an old newspaper from, you know, this day, you know, every year, and just moving forward from the 1900s, and maybe not be able to understand the context of what it meant to society in general, because I think it takes that level of analysis of the facts of what it really means. And so
And if you don't have the best source that you could have is the people themselves, well, you don't have them.
Yeah,
they're not here anymore. Maybe their children or grandchildren can recall things, but not. You're still getting a distance there from what they actually understood or what motivated them. But you know, I tend to have as someone who does more of what we would call social history, you know. There are economic arrangements, cultural arrangements. That does tell you what did people value the most, what motivated them to make decisions they made. That's easier to see if you think about those types of relationships. You know, what mattered the most to, you know, Polish immigrants in Wheeling? Well, it's family, their religion, their culture, this sort of working class community to a certain extent as well. And so any of the institutions tied to that, if you see their membership in any of those institutions, you know these are things you value. They're not just things you join to put on your resume. At that time, you join them because these are things that are important or are in some way actually helping assist the family, the community, or what have you. Yeah.
And I think it's interesting to see how things evolve to being and then evolve out of being and are replaced by other things. And do you ever get into any of the stuff which would be more of just the daily life of what it's like to live in a time period around here? The West Wing, I used to love that show. In one episode, the one woman, Donna, she had a book of, you know, what life was like at the turn of the century, and she kept revealing facts, and I'm like, I need to find this book. I never did because I'm lazy. But that idea of just sitting here as we're talking about this, you know, I'm getting little flashes in my mind, and I'm sure on the way home it'll make me really think a lot about what it was like to move here as an immigrant and with everything being so crowded and living next to a factory and just what daily life would have to be.
Yeah, that chapter I was mentioning earlier on, that's really what that chapter is. And it was one of those ones, like my old undergraduate thesis started out being very, very long because of it's really descriptive, and you have to sort of get the description to really understand what people are living with. So, you know, things like how much does it actually cost to rent a boarding house in Wheeling?
Yeah. How much of your salary?
Yeah, how much relatively is it? What is it actually like to work in one of these establishments? Yeah. I mean, we have ideas of what we think this is like, but what we quickly realize it's very dangerous.
Yeah.
I mean, one of the other constant things that would have been reported in the daily newspaper at this time is people getting hurt and killed in the mines and the factories. And it's actually, at the time, because of sort of the mentality of the time, it's reported as if reporting on a sporting event.
Yeah.
Very graphic descriptions of how people die. And I have a whole section just, I mean, you could call it like 500 ways to get maimed or die. I mean, just the, you know, annual Department of Mine reports where they just graphically describe what happens to somebody. But that, you know, just imagine at the time, if you live in a community like that, that would have been the thing that people are talking about.
Yeah.
If they don't have social media, but the thing that would have spread around very quickly, did you hear what happened to so-and-so?
Because it could happen to you, right?
At any moment. And the fact that, you know, not just happening to male adults, it can happen to kids. There are kids that, you know, are having to work in these establishments. There's a lot of women that work in a lot of these manufacturing establishments. What is it like dealing with the pollution in Wheeling at that time? You know, some of the more interesting information I got was actually there's a document up here in the Wheeling room about some of the health conditions in Wheeling in 1913, and that the city was very concerned about some of the rising health problems, typhoid fever, diphtheria, some of these other things. And what they realized using a more scientific approach is, why is everyone getting typhoid fever? Well, they did a map showing, this is where all of the water intake sites are. Here's all the outdoor privies in Wheeling.
Yeah.
And the map is, it's amazing. All the little red dots are where there's an outdoor privy. And usually you have the sort of common water pump, and there's about 20 to 25 within a very short radius of there. Well, and the report quickly realizes this is probably not the wisest policy continuing. Also that, you know, Wheeling didn't have a filtrated water system until 1915 and got their water directly from the Ohio River.
Wow.
Which, you know, there's also news reports.
They also dumped everything.
There was a series of news reports I remember from the summer of 1909 where they're describing people shocked looking at the Ohio River that it's orangish in color and that there are thousands of dead fish floating down the river. But just that sort of daily life of realizing, like, you live in a place that, honestly, everyone wants to, romanticize things.
Sure.
And, you know, this is the heyday of Wheeling. But at the same time, it's a dirty, smelly place to be in certain places.
And probably that time in general, it was a much more dirty, smelly world to live in.
Sure. And, you know, it takes time for people to, you know, in the early 20th century to really start saying, you know, we could actually make things a little bit better for people if we just do some basic things. I mean, Wheeling didn't have a system of garbage collection until like 1912, 1913. They used to take the garbage, burn it on top of the hillsides, the one hillside across from OV, the sort of other sort of hill across from East Wheeling. They would just put it on top of the hill and burn it. If you look at any photographs from the early 20th century of Wheeling, if any of them show you the hillsides, what you quickly notice, there's no trees on any of the hillsides. It's garbage. They have clear-cut all of the hillsides. People are constantly in the newspaper talking about there's no water in Wheeling Creek this week. Wow.
And we're back. Like I said earlier, it wouldn't be the James Wodarcyk Experimental Podcast if I didn't occasionally screw up. My plug was not in the outlet, and we were running on battery power, and I looked over, and it was almost out of batteries. But damn, we're back in the game here, and
yeah, we were talking about sort of, you know, daily life in Wheeling at that time. I mean, just imagine as well that there are streets where you would have horse traffic, automobile traffic, streetcar,
just the
railroad,
the merging of all these different technologies. You have horses and cars at the same time on a road, and trying to integrate that into society in a city had to been.
I mean, just, you know, you don't see it in some of these sort of photographs from the time period of Market or Main Street in downtown Wheeling, but if you can, if you get some of these photographs that sort of amateurs took at the time, you can very easily see it.
Yeah.
This was one of the things that, for this book manuscript, the one thing I wanted was to try to get some pictures that weren't pristine.
Yeah.
To get some pictures showing these areas where there's a horse cart, there's a streetcar. Yeah. You know, there's all this stuff going
on. Probably not necessarily like really good traffic laws either, right?
No, I mean, just imagining trying to get around. I mean, at that time, it would take you a good while to get around a place like Wheeling.
I saw an old film of, I think it was old Chicago, and there's horses and cars, and they're just, and there's people walking right down the same street. There's no sidewalks from what I could tell, and there's a few cars and a few horse and buggies, and they're just finding their own path through, like you do the Italian festival when you used to be up here on Market Street, that where you just kind of find a little area where you can navigate up the road. There was no rhyme or reason to it, and people just kind of figured it out.
Yeah, and I mean, that was life in Wheeling during that sort of the industrial boom period, was just trying to navigate the dangers of that, but also just the common annoyances if you live in a neighborhood where there's all that excess traffic that when you go home at night, there is no real peace because the train still goes down the middle. I think it's either I think it's 17th Street here. The middle of 17th Street was a railroad. Would literally run, and there's good photographs from the mid 20th century where you see the train going down the middle of the street and there's cars parked.
Wow.
So yeah, I can't get in my car and drive because there's a train going down the middle of our street at the moment.
Right in front of your house.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, I think those are the types of, like you mentioned, those are those daily experiences that really shape people's understanding of a place that they live in at the time that you don't appreciate now if you just go there and look, because you can't
see it.
You can't get a sense of it, or unfortunately because of, you know, Wheeling's decline in the last few decades, you can't get necessarily a sense of how packed in the city was.
So the era right before they had trash collection, how many people lived in the city, would you say?
At its high point in the early 20th century, I mean, anywhere between 60, 75,000 people. The census gives you sort of relative numbers, but at certain times in between there, you have a lot more people living in the area. I mean, if you take the community of Benwood, where the main steel mills were, is a great example of this. I mean, in the census, it usually only shows at the high point maybe 4,500, 5,000 people. Yeah. There would be times when there's 8,000, 10,000 people that live in Benwood.
Wow.
When the mills are going full steam, coal mines are going full steam, there's nowhere for people to really live.
And now this would be before the era of, because I always think about indoor plumbing, and it's just, it's horrifying to me, the idea that you'd have to use an outhouse. The house I live in right now, it was built before indoor plumbing in my grandparents' house. I was like, why is the bathroom here? And they're like, well, we added it in, you know, long after we moved here. And that's why the bathroom in my house is in a weird location, because they literally had to build an addition onto the house for a bathroom. Before that, you just walked out the door. And so, but I always think about it in the context of rural living, because my family and the stories I hear were all rural. But then just thinking about it now, that many people in the city, let's just be honest, they got poop every day.
Yeah.
And they also have to get food brought in. And how do you feed, you know, what's essentially an army of that many people? Would you say 70,000?
It's high point. Yeah, I mean, that's also this orientation of Wheeling sort of as being a hub. In the 19th century, it was always a hub for these rural farming communities as well, because for those farming families, they knew that if you wanted to sell your excess produce or beef or whatever it might be, you can go come to Wheeling and sell that, and you know, turn, you know, basically that's how they made a living. So the market houses were literally market houses. Yeah. They were open air market houses. The one in North Wheeling, sort of where the Market Auditorium used to be, Center Market as well. Those were very, very dense spaces because you would have farmers come in from out of town, set up their carts, set up operations, and sell.
Yeah.
And that's how people would get in that earlier period. Over time, you know, railroad traffic makes it a little bit easier to bring in refrigerated meat, for example, even though Wheeling had a number of slaughterhouses as well, so you could get your meat pretty easily that way. Truck traffic, once we start getting paved roads, helps as well. But, you know, a lot of it is sort of that earlier sort of the rural-urban connection that just because it's an urban area, it is very much tied into these sort of peripheral rural regions around it.
Yeah, because before, I guess, the era of the mass transportation, that the only way that you can get enough food in is that people that live relatively close would grow it and bring it in, or raise it and bring it into the city. It's fascinating to me just how what a pain in the ass it would be to live back there. Probably very interesting as well. I mean, I'm sure that's just your daily life. I think, you know, maybe 50 years from now, they'll look back and go, oh, they had to drive a car to and find a place to park with it.
Well, yeah, it's like now the sort of practice of, you know, online grocery shopping that, you know, at that time, it's like living in a big city. You don't have refrigerators.
Yeah.
So literally you go every single day to the store to get food. And that's why if you look at a city directory from that turn of the century, there are so many grocery stores. That is like the most, other than a saloon before Prohibition, it is the one sort of establishment that sort of up-and-coming sort of business person in an immigrant community could really get into.
Yeah.
Because there's always a need, because there's never enough.
Yeah.
There's no sort of supermarket. There's no Kroger or Walmart to go to. You would go to the corner because every day you have to go to the corner and get your meat, your vegetables, or whatever else.
And now we have one Kroger, the Mount Shuttle Kroger. That's insane that it went from, you know, however many there was then to basically one major grocery store that.
Yeah, that was, and that's a trend in the 20th century that's developed, you know, from the beginning, partly from this sort of dense urban crowding, a sort of consolidation, efficiency. Efficiency comes by lower prices through sort of having control over distribution, over networking, and, you know, shopping malls, Walmarts, Krogers, things
and
like
instead
that.
Instead of the produce coming from across the river, it's coming from California or Florida or maybe even overseas.
Yeah. So, but until you have things like some of the key technologies, refrigerated railroad cars that can actually haul something from California all the way to a place like Wheeling and can haul meat and other things. It all has to come sourced locally or regionally.
And the idea of an ice box where they would cut ice blocks from the Great Lakes, right, and bring it down, and they'd put a chunk of ice in a literal ice box to keep your food cold for however many days till it melted, and then you'd have to get another chunk of ice.
Yeah, they used to do that, too, on Wheeling Creek in East Wheeling. They used to have several establishments that would do and. When it would get cold, would cut ice to sell. I don't know if I'd want to be using the ice that's coming from where the tanneries are, where some of the steel mills are. But, you know, that was the common sort of practice at that time of the year, was to get your chunk of ice so that you could hold this stuff over, at least during the winter months, a little bit more. So,
Interesting. And how the changes are so gradual that you know, my dad, he definitely remembers the outhouse, and he probably would even remember people that had ice boxes before refrigeration, and because there's always the holdouts are like, I don't need electric, I'll just you know, even the house that I live in has very few outlets, and it has no ceiling light fixtures because people didn't have that many appliances. When I moved in, I'm like, why are there no outlets? They're like, well, you might have a radio, and people didn't have computers and all these different things that they had to plug in a wall. You probably didn't need half the outlets that you already had. Maybe an electric sewing machine that you plugged in every now and then.
Well, you had an indoor fireplace.
Yeah,
that was your heating source.
Yeah.
So you don't need to have, you know, all these other sort of aspects. I mean, it's interesting to be able to judge, like in a place like here in Wheeling, you can judge the relative date of how old a house is by not necessarily, you can judge it by looking at the outside architecture, but going inside, you can also judge it by things like, there's not that many outlets here. Oh, there's a lot, I see gas fixtures that are still in place.
Right.
The bathroom's a great example. You know, if it's
an afterthought.
Well, if it's on the side or the back of the house,
it's
probably something that was added on much later.
If it's in the middle, it's built with the house.
And if you have one of the fancier homes in Wheeling, where it might have been in sort of North Wheeling, where it was one of the more sort of manufacturing or financial families, they probably did have it.
Yeah.
So it was actually in a sensible location. But, you know, in some of the oldest of the oldest houses in Wheeling, if it's there, it's in a back added on building. It's in the side because if you look at a Sanborn insurance map from the time, it'll show where the house is, and then it'll show this little structure in the back corner that has an O written on it.
For outhouse.
Yeah, and that's what it is. And almost every house you notice has one of those. Or it's in the house and you can see where – you know, it's an addition, and it's got very clearly demarked on there.
Well, yeah, you know, there's that era where people went from, oh, you have a TV, we just have a radio. Oh, you have an indoor toilet. We had, you know, we haven't moved up to that. Oh, you have the new iPhone, whatever. So-and-so still using a flip phone.
Yeah.
The progression of that stuff is interesting. And, of course, now it's, the crazy thing, I think, is how fast it's all accelerated.
Yeah, it's accelerated a lot faster than it did at that time.
Yeah.
I mean, one of the funny categories just in the census from 1920 to 1930, because in the 20s is sort of this era of when you see a lot of these new consumer products start coming into vogue, or things that maybe were created but now in the 20s are cheap enough for people to maybe purchase. They actually create a column in the census of 1930 to kind of judge for this. And in trying to think of what is the item we want to ask. Automobile, that may not be the best in urban areas. You know, indoor plumbing has kind of started to come in the decade earlier. They pick radio. There is a column that asks, does this household have a radio or not? That was the one thing that if it's rural or urban, depending on whatever the household size is, that would tell you something about the sort of success or sort of disposable income of a family. of all things, a radio.
And that's the interesting topic to bring up, the disposable income. We kind of touched upon it earlier. The amount of your wages that went for housing and for food, and what little was left over for clothing maybe and a few other things, and that if we had to live like that now, we would be considered impoverished.
Yeah, I mean, you know, scholars that look at this, they refer to it as sort of a culture of making do without, elements of sort of people who come from a rural background. So whether it's African Americans from the South migrating to the North in the early 20th century, Polish immigrants who come from a rural background and have certain habits that then, even if they live in an urban area, you start quickly noticing some of these. So great-grandmother had a practice of canning vegetables on a regular basis. You know, there's an oral interview describing somebody from Blaine, or sort of one of those mining communities, talking about how the immigrant father had a little smokehouse that he created so that, you know, the meat that they would get would literally be the meat that he provided.
Yeah.
So that even though he was still tied into working for the mining company, he had a little smokehouse going. Or, you know, things like making some moonshine. Well, we don't have to go buy any alcohol because we can just make it in the basement because we have a small still that's set up. Maybe, you know,
one garden and
or maybe one member of the extended family can sew.
Yeah.
And so we may have to actually go buy clothes, but we won't have to buy them on a regular basis because we can repair the clothes. We don't need an automobile because honestly, it's so crowded here. There's no need for having an automobile. So if we do get enough money to get anything, the thing you hear in things like oral interviews of people that grew up or are alive at that time, they say, well, Dad thought at this point it was okay to finally get a radio because he said, you know what, that's something that actually we can listen to music on. It's some form of entertainment. it's a, not a necessity that we could actually probably deal with ourselves. We cannot have our own radio station. So,
and that's a high-tech luxury item at that time, right?
Oh,
that's,
sure.
Definitely a mark of...
Sure. I mean, it would have been, you know, several months' wages for somebody to buy a radio set or to buy it on an installment plan. Yeah. To afford it, even a crude refrigerator. Once those start coming in the 20s or so, you know, that's, you know, washer and dryer would just be unheard of because that's just too...
You don't need that.
That's a luxury item.
Without,
you can live without that. So, yeah.
And even, I think at one point in time, being able to afford a good pair of shoes would have been... I seem to remember maybe my grandfather talking about how, you know, it was a big deal if you were the oldest, you would get a new pair of shoes... because everybody else had hand-me-downs, and the idea of hand-me-downs is almost unheard of these days. Well, you know, Bobby likes, you know, red shirts, and Timmy, he doesn't want to wear his brother's clothes, and you just throw it away and go to Walmart and get a new one. But, yeah, hand-me-downs were legit back then. That was
If you look in the city directories in Wheeling at the time, the number of shoe repair, hat repair, you know, people that could fix things. I mean, that was sort of... That was common in many medium-sized, large communities that you can't afford. People don't have the disposable income to do that.
Yeah.
So they have to rely on people that can, you know, fix things. And when automobiles come around, what are some of the immediate types of small businesses you see develop? Garages.
Yeah.
Because people say it was a big investment to buy that Ford Model T.
Yeah.
And because it is breaking down because of how bad the roads might be, we're going to take it to the garage and get it fixed instead of just going out and buying another.
Yeah, right, yeah. Not almost nothing was seen as being disposable back then. They would really, which is kind of a great way of living, where they really used everything until they could not be used anymore and even repurposed it. Like I'm looking around I should mention that we are in the boardroom of the Ohio County Public Library, and they have a beautiful display of glass jars from, I'm not sure.
Hazel Atlas,
okay, yes. And just the idea of how many people that did at-home canning and reuse these products over and over and over again.
Beautiful.
And some of these things that I see as being familiar that even people in my family would have had similar items in their own homes. And I even to this day remember going to my grandparents' house, and the plates that we ate dinner on were the same ones the whole time I was growing up. And probably my mom ate off of those plates when she was a kid. You didn't go out and get a new set of plates unless for some reason they all broke all at once.
Yeah, or, you know, in a place like Wheeling, the only reason you would do that is during one of the major floods. And let's say if you weren't used to being in Wheeling, you just recently arrived, that's one of the things people quickly learned was that's why you can also tell a lot of the homes that are built after the flooding started to become a problem, particularly in South Wheeling, you'll notice some of the homes there that are set up with larger porches.
Right.
2-3-story structures as opposed to, you don't see many one-story homes that were built in the late 19th, early 20th century because they knew this is going to flood.
Yeah.
There's no reason to have this as a one-story because everything will be destroyed.
Yeah.
So second, third, fourth-story homes, you know, brick homes that are going to be stable. When there's a flood coming, you move everything to the top few floors. Yeah. And that's why that it's only in a couple of these dramatic floods like 1936 where... Okay, that's so high. It's up to the second, third floor of some of these homes. Then people would lose things. But when there's just a normal flood, just move it up to the second floor, third floor, we'll be fine. We won't have to buy new furniture or new anything else, and then just clean out the bottom floor.
It's just one of those parts of life.
Every spring, usually every spring, that was sort of the thing that you would prepare for, that there is the potential the Ohio River could dramatically flood.
Yeah, that's crazy. We don't even... think of that.
I mean, we haven't had, I think the last big flood I remember was 2004.
Yeah.
You know, and I think if we had one now, people would probably go, they'd freak out.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I mean, Facebook would just blow up with people. What do we do? I mean, this is terrible. It's like, well, back at that time, it was every year and sometimes multiple times. I mean, what would be the ones that would surprise people is when maybe it was before that season would start, like it happens in the fall for some reason.
An odd storm.
Or you have early March, you had a small flood. Okay, well, we've gotten it out of our system. And then 2 weeks later, it's a much more massive flood. Or the one in 1907 where it literally starts the evening, morning of one day. And over the course of the day, it just rises dramatically. And it's so fast, people just don't have the time to do that. But, that's another element of just making do at that time.
Sure.
Sort of trying to get by in sort of an industrial sort of location. But,
crazy. Yeah. Well, Hal, this has been great.
It has been.
We've done we've done almost an hour and a half.
Wow, cool.
And it's a very entertaining hour and a half. This will be the first episode of the new year, and I'm kind of relaunching with, I think I mentioned earlier, I'm going to try to do History Month. So you'll know by the description if this is the one history podcast, but Travis Henline's going to be in this same place tomorrow, and then I'm going to twist Sean's arm and get him in, because I think that as we've discussed here today, that this area and West Virginia and in the bigger picture has such a great history. And I think that we're living in a really cool time where a lot of people have an interest in it. So I want to thank you for coming on and talk about this. I know we had discussed it over the summer and we finally made it happen. And
cool.
Anything else you want to add? Or
no, I think it's been very fun and entertaining and I'm glad to have been a part of it.
Great. All right. Well, on behalf of Hal Gorby, I'm James Wodarcyk. Thanks for tuning into the podcast and we'll see you on the next one. I can't.